I am grand. I am grand. How you be?
Good. You're not off to the Ukraine or anything crazy, are you?
Actually, I am. Well, I'm not off to the Ukraine, but I'm off to DC
Oh, same thing.
to do some cybersecurity consulting out there. So.
Very good, very good. I'm going to ask you, what do you call the independent military people who go to different countries? Independent people who go to countries to fight and stuff like that. Are they doing that for what do they call those guys?
Mercenaries.
No, we don't.
Mercenaries, contractors.
Do they are mercenaries going to the Ukraine? It's just silly idea that popped in my head here.
Have no idea,
I was just wondering, they're putting up a hell of a fight over there, aren't they?
yeah, that's what it looks like.
What's the lesson? We have a couple of military people here. What's the lesson to be learned from that?
Oh my goodness. No idea what lessons to be learned about privacy. It's really a cyber warfare happening right now. So,
No, I think bullets are flying, man. Man, the internet may be down, but the bullets are definitely flying over there. Well, anyway, excuse me. Let's do the open forum here. Get start things started. A little bit of news. Oops, someone's giving me feedback. Paul McCartney just sold his New York City apartment, his luxury apartment. He bought it for 15 million in 2014, and he just sold it for $8 million. Kind of interesting, huh?
That doesn't sound like a good deal.
No, it doesn't.
He's worth a billion. He can handle it.
Oh, a billion here, a billion there. You're right, Sean. But the thing is, the real estate went to his. He sold something and lost 50% on an apartment in Manhattan. I look for little clues and things like that. He's been trying to sell it for a long time, and for whatever he overpaid, not that long ago, I think 2014 or 15, he bought it 15 million, and today he's selling it for 8 million in this market. What do you think that, what do you think that's indicative of? Maybe it was a crummy apart, maybe it was a crummy apartment.
$15 million crummy apartment. I don't know, man.
Well, nobody wanted it, right? And he lost 50 cents on the dollar on that apartment. It was in
You
the
know
little,
where it was located, Claude?
I'm sure Manhattan.
Well, I know, but Upper East Side,
And
Central Park West.
I don't know the specifics. I'm sure it was in a good neighborhood. You can afford it, like Sean just said. Absolutely. Anyway, I look for things like that. Is this a trend? Is this an anomaly? What's going on? How long is real estate going to stay strong with inflation going crazy? With the with the interest rates going to go up, and with the geopolitical thing that's going on right now. I said earlier in my predictions, I thought by the third or fourth quarter we'd have an adjustment in real estate. Right now I'm leaning towards something much earlier. I don't know. Depends on the politics also, what's going on in the world right now. Questions, open forum time. Who has a question or a role play? This is your time.
I have a quick question, Claude. I've been working on a, well, I'm a consultant on a pure option deal that's happening here in Augusta, Georgia.
Tell everybody what a pure option deal is first.
I guess it's deeper than just the name. Pure option, we're strictly just buying the home at an agreed price from the seller with the option to buy it in X amount of years or in time specific to that. So it's pretty simple. But my client said again, Claude, you're
It's an
muted.
option absent a mute option an option absent a rental portion. It just means that
Yes.
for a given period of time, you can buy it for a
Yeah.
certain price without renting in it, living in it, or anything else. It has nothing to do with
Right.
occupancy.
Right. Has nothing to do with occupancy. Thank you. But my question was, my client was very concerned with the word option. He felt like the client or the seller could always come back and say, you know what, I decided not to sell this property to you at, let's say 3, 4 years down the line or whatnot. And then he will just be stuck with, the the home or the seller will be stuck with his escrow or earner's money and such things like that. My response to him was, well, the option is in your favor as the buyer, not the seller. So don't think of it in a way that the seller can come back and change his mind, you know. But at the end of the day, you know, we did close the deal, or he got the property, but he still to this day, as he's occupying the home, feels kind of feels like he's not supported legally. So he went out and got an attorney. An attorney looked over the pure option and was talking with him and was like, yeah, this is not a good agreement. The option is not in your favor. And I was, what are you about to say, Claude? Go ahead.
I was going to say, what language specifically, here's a rule from law school. I had a great contracts professor. It was my favorite subject. And he said, always go back to the contract. So if it was not in his favor, what was the specific verbiage? That an option is absolute. I guess there can be conditions to it, but an option says that you can buy this property for this price under during this time period. Unless there's were there other conditions or something that took it out of the ability to be an option?
No other terms.
Okay, so your answer is always, sir, let's go over the contract. Do you see anything in here in this contract that would take away your right to purchase this property over the next 24 months for this $250,000 price? No.
Right.
Well, that's why we do a contract, sir. That's why it's notarized. That's why we write it down to protect you. If for some reason there's a breach of the contract on the part of the seller, you have legal recourse.
Yes, I got you. Thank you for that.
So did the attorney try to kill the deal after the fact?
Yes, he did. And double back and said, well, this is a better contract. And he instead of doing the pure option, my client, he went back with this attorney to do a wraparound mortgage.
Oh, how did you change that with the seller?
And this is why I'm glad I got my consulting fee, and I'm letting those guys handle it because it's a cat fight over there. But it was a lesson learned with me, because I told him, hey, man, the deal is done. Like, you have the property, you have its signature, it's notarized. You have the option to buy this home in 5 years at $250,000. He wasn't comfortable with that. He got an attorney.
Okay.
The attorney went back, read the pure option agreement and said, okay, no, this is a better one. We need to do a wraparound mortgage. And now they're setting up to close with the seller sometime next week.
Why did you agree to this metamorphosis, this change?
Well, as a consultant for the buyer, I just wanted him to be comfortable. I wanted him to be happy and proud and be content with what's happening. If he felt like the pure option was not supporting him legally, okay, I wanted him to be comfortable. So he went out and got his own attorney, and I'm not going to dispute with, because I'm not an attorney. And if this attorney is holding his badge up saying, well, I'm telling you this, a contract is not good, you know, who am I to tell him, hey, man, you know.
Tell me next time, ask why is it not good? Where does it say not good? That's your opinion.
Yes.
So forth. The bottom line is, did you get paid?
Facts. I'm good. I've got paid.
Okay. That's why are we in business? I always go back
to get paid today.
Why are
today.
We in business, everybody? To get paid
today.
Today. Come on, unison here. Come on. It's like karaoke here, except we're talking about business. Okay. We're in business to get paid today. It doesn't matter how you do it. So good for you for thinking on your feet. You started the deal originally as a pure option. You then wanted to switch. You had trouble with the client. He or she got nervous. And then you switched it to a consulting fee, and you're paid and out of the deal at this point.
Yes.
I have no problem with that.
Yeah. And the only question was, why would this attorney come with a wraparound mortgage?
Why is the sky blue? I mean, why is Putin in Ukraine? I mean,
you're right. Yeah. You know,
different attorneys. I'll answer that question. Attorneys are in business to find problems.
Yes.
Okay? If the attorney said to your client, this is wonderful, this is the best contract I ever seen, you shouldn't have even come in here.
Yeah.
Does he make any money?
At all. at all.
So what's the answer to your question? Why did the attorney find, oh my God, this is the worst contract I ever saw.
Why
do that? Because that's how they make money.
That's how they make money. Yep. They
always find a problem because that's in their best interest. Sometimes when you're playing, you know, negotiation in business is kind of like a chess game, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Do you have to be a mind reader? Literally, do you have to, maybe not a mind reader, but do you have to anticipate why other people say and do the things that they do before they do it? Is that a good business person?
That's deep.
If you can anticipate before you go to a meeting or a negotiation and think to yourself, gee, what's going on in this person's mind? What are they going to negotiate? What are they going to find wrong with this? And you're prepared mentally for that. Yeah. That's the way you go into battle. You know, negotiation, business is a battle, isn't it? It's a test of battle. Brandon, I know you're dying to jump in on this. Brandon Simmons, there you go. I see you.
Hey there.
Is going into
I'm a fly on the wall.
Is going into a negotiation. You do a lot of real estate, Brandon. And when you go into a negotiation with somebody, do you try to anticipate two or three things, write them down, what might come up and how to defend yourself or how to answer things that come up? Do you try to anticipate things?
Sure. I think what's best though, Claude, is what kind of, like, it's like, I don't know if you're saying have a script. I never have a script, but I kind of try to be prepared for those rebuttals and those questions and stuff like that.
Sure. If you have somebody calls you up, they're very excited about doing a deal. Okay, but you don't know this person and you need some cash up front. What's one of the first things you want to do in the first couple of minutes with this person?
Qualify them.
For
money.
Money, baby.
See if they have some cash.
Okay. Biggest mistake I made in the early days of my business. I'd give $1 million presentations. I'd get in my car, I'd drive through traffic. I'd buy them lunch and lattes. And then at the end of everything, they'd say, Claude, this is great. And if I had the money, the minute I get the money, what are you going to do, rob a 7-Eleven? Where's the money? Why didn't I qualify them for money up front before I expended all that time and information and resources? Okay. Do you think we have rights in the sales process? Good topic. What do you think, Nehemiah?
Oh, yeah. The salesman comes first, right?
The salesman always comes first.
Yeah.
That's very controversial. I don't know if people are going to like you saying that. Why should the salesperson come first when every other sales trainer in the world says the direct opposite of what I believe in? Why do I have that perception, that viewpoint, that we should come first?
You know, honestly, I believe the salesman comes first. It's our position to manipulate in a positive way or in a way where the buyer or seller is making a decision that's best suited for them, where we're able to paint that picture that satisfies their desire. And in our defense, it's our job to really drive home the deal and make it. Just imagine for a moment, we're able to paint those pictures. We're able to go in and say, hey, it's your job to make sure these people are comfortable with the deal. They don't have no, you know, recourse or any type of buyer's remorse or seller's remorse. We eliminate all those things. And the salesman is the architect of these deals, you know, so it's our job. We should come first.
We should come. Anybody else want to chime in on that? The salesman comes first. What the hell? That's crazy.
I was going to say he mentioned one thing I thought was really good is it's a lot of, and you do this, Claude, very well, is qualify at the end. Like, is there some reason why we would not be able to move forward? Like, you're re-qualifying the close, making sure that they're going to go ahead and move forward, that there's no other excuses, no other decision makers. We're ready to move forward.
Yeah. Hey, Mr. Simmons, the price on this property, it's all set up. It's owner finance. It's a 20-year mortgage with a balloon in 8 years. And we need $25,000 up front to get this done. Is that comfortable for your budget today if you like the home?
Yeah, I think I can swing that.
Think?
Yeah.
I don't understand, sir. You think, or is that money the source of that money? $25,000 is a lot of money, and I have a lot of people calling me on this. Yeah, I'd love to do business with you.
Do I just wire it to the title company?
You can wire it to the title company. You can put a earnest money deposit down today. We can call my attorney. You can wire. Can you wire that money in the next 24 hours to the title company if we decide to move forward today?
Yeah, I'm allowed to wire up to $100,000 at a time.
Okay, so you're pre-qualified. That the source of that money is in your general savings or checking account or something like that?
My business checking.
Okay, and the money, boom. Off the roll. Thank you, Brandon. What did I do today that I should have done when I first got started? I didn't do stuff like that. Why do I do that so strenuously today?
Saves time.
It's time.
And helps. It helps you have a sustainable business.
Yeah.
You got to know that stuff up ahead of time.
Bailey, how many times have we had people manipulate us with those? Brandon tried to do it. I think he did it on purpose. I'm not sure. But he knows this stuff pretty well. He said the word think. Why do prospects use those wishy-washy words all the time?
They don't want to give commitment.
They want to give
to. It's a habit.
Exactly. They don't want to give a commitment. It's a little escape plan. I think they do it subconsciously. This is great. Yeah, I love this deal. My wife loves the house. I think we could do this pretty well. I don't think they do it intentionally. I think they do it subconsciously because this gives them a way out if something goes wrong. You ever get the phone call later on? Oh, Claude, you know, we had a little bit of a hiccup here, a little bit of a problem. Give me about a week or two. I should be able to get the money out of my 501k or whatever, 301k, whatever it is. Whose fault is that when that kind of stuff happens? Whose fault is it?
It's the salesman.
It's the salesman's fault.
Yeah.
You leave nothing to chance. You listen acutely for those little ambiguous words they love to use. Okay. So that they, believe me, and then you summarize it. When we close, we do the agenda. Hey, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to ask you questions you're going to ask me. Then you qualify for money, time, motivation, authority to make a decision, and character to keep it. And then you do your close. And your close is a summarization. Hey, Mr. Harvard, you and I just discussed, we're going to do a 3-year rent to own. It's going to be $250,000. And you're going to put $15,000 down or wire it to me before 5 o'clock today. Are we on the same page, sir? Is that your understanding of this deal?
Yeah, that is my understanding of the deal. You know, it's amazing how fast this happened. My goodness.
Yep. My wife said the same thing on our honeymoon. that's the worst joke in the world.
Yeah, that's dangerous.
The thing about it is you don't leave anything to chance. You listen acutely for those maybe, probably, should have, could have. Oh, this is one. They usually do this very well. The prospects have this wonderful system of their own. They have their own little gut system where they stroke and nurture you. Anybody ever get a prospect? Oh, you're great. I love doing. Oh, this is wonderful. This is the best deal. Oh, you returned my phone. Oh, this is so great. Thank you so much. I think there won't be any problems with this. And I'll get back to you in the near distant future. We'll talk again real soon and we'll make this happen. Okay. Just take it off the market for now. Send me the contracts and we'll follow up in a day or two. Okay, buddy. Anybody ever have a prospect that sounds like that? What goes in the mind of the amateur salesperson when they hear that stuff? Oh, I got it. Who's the man? Oh, I closed this deal. You didn't close shit. Because they just set it up for you. You're getting off the phone or leaving the appointment and say, oh, I'm going to crush it. And then you're chasing this guy like he's on witness protection, right? Anybody have that deal where you just keep leaving messages and messages? Hi, Mr. Harvard, Claude Diamond. I haven't heard from you. You were supposed to send me that wire with the money on Monday, and here it is Friday, and I've left you about 88 messages. Could you please call me as soon as you get this? Do we do that? Who's in control?
I've been there before. I've definitely been there.
Who's in control when we let them do that to us?
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, and you have no, my mentor used to always say, Claude, there's no bad prospects. There's only shitty salesmen. He said, that's when you take responsibility for the conversation and everything. And then you do the close. The close, we don't talk enough about closing, but you've got to really put the last nail in the coffin and be specific. I'm on it. Brandon, you're going to wire. I'll send you the information and the agreement. You're going to look it over, send me back the agreement, and you're going to wire that money before 5 o'clock today to the title company. Are we on this? Is that what we're going to do today, Brandon?
Yeah, it should be wired earlier. I think the wire cut off for me is around 2 o'clock. It should be wired.
Yeah. Could you do me a small favor? Could you get me back the contract before 2 o'clock? I'm sending DocuSign. And could you send me a confirmation email when you wire the money today?
Sure.
I'm sorry, what?
Not a problem. I can do both.
Okay. I can do both.
I'll send you a confirmation of the wire and get that DocuSign over to you.
You're great. Thank you, sir. Before we go, is there any reason why we won't go through with this? Do you have any questions or do you have any hesitation or anything like that at this point? Because we did this fast, like you said. Are you comfortable with all this?
Right. I'm looking for more houses just like that one.
Okay. So. Well, maybe I can help you after we do this one. But there's no reason why you would call me later and say you had a change of heart or anything like that, right?
Nope.
Oh, okay.
Nope. I can go ahead and sign it right now if you want
to. I love doing business with you. You're a man of your word. You're old school. I love that. Thank you so much. Boom. That's a lot of work off the role play. That's a lot of work that I just did. And it might be, did anyone get the feeling that I was pushing it a little too much? Because I was. Do you think you need to push it a little too much at the very end?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Why?
Absolutely. I have lost deals because of that. I've been too nice and like excited and not reconfirm. And it's bit me in the butt. So. Now it's just, if they're committed, they're committed. So
that's you're on that honeymoon period. You know, that nice time when everybody, the prospects made a decision, you worked out the money, you got the time frame, the contracts, no matter what business you're in, there's that little honeymoon period, right? Where everybody's happy. Okay, we're going to go to deal. I made a decision. You're going to make a commission. You're spending it already in your head. The prospect said yes. That window is starting to close very quickly. That's the last chance you're going to get to put the nail in to get that final absolute commitment. If you do that little move, the chances of them having regrets or remorse or calling you back the next day have been tremendously. I'm sorry. Yeah. Joseph, you got to mute yourself when you're on the phone. That's when your moment. That's when you've got to go for it. That's your last shot. And you've reduced, mathematically, you put all the forces of the universe in your favor then, because now it's a matter of ego and pride. Oh, I can't call Claude and tell him I changed my mind. I gave him my word. Is that stuff important in business? You better believe it. The ladies have joined us, Jessica and Suzette. Hi. Hello.
Good morning.
Good morning. So do either of ladies first. Any questions here on open forum? Do you like what we're talking about this morning?
Yes, I just tuned in. I was a little late. I had a little trouble getting in. So
where are you now? Every time I talk to you, you're either in Alabama, Las Vegas, California, or somewhere. Where are you today?
Today I'm in San Diego, California. Okay.
What's the weather? How's the weather in San Diego?
Beautiful. As I'm done, I'm going out for my run.
I did my run this morning. But it was 10 degrees, and I have to actually work. There's so much snow here. How much snow is there? I have to wear these spikes, these things called micro spikes, on my shoes because we have snow and ice here. Good stuff, Nehemiah and Brandon. Thank you so much. Let's go around the room. Open forum time. Questions, role plays. Joseph is waving hello. You have to unmute yourself, Joseph. We can't hear you. You have to unmute yourself. Okay, well, he's working on that.
Yeah, I did.
Yes,
can you hear me? Yes. Question. If I'm calling regarding for rent, and they're saying, first, you have to fill out application. Do we need to proceed with something or just keep them?
I'm sorry, you want them to fill out an
No. We are calling for ad regarding rent.
Okay.
Okay, and they say that first you have to fill out application.
Okay, I don't have a problem filling out that application. I can send it to you right now, sir. Are you looking for someone with a certain line of credit and an employment and source of funds, correct?
Yes.
Could I just send you a copy of my credit report? I have the latest one here.
Okay. And and how would it help actually?
Well, it's my credit report. It'll show you my credit worthiness, my score, the amount of credit I have and everything else. I'll be glad to send that and an application if you like. What happens when we speak an hour from now?
I don't know.
Well, sir, you asked me for credit information. I'm glad to give that to you. I have no problem providing that to you. And I would do the same thing if I was in your position, but I just want to know if I have the best credit you've ever seen, can we do this? Can we do a rent to own today?
So just to ask first rent to own, because it's just for rent.
Well, I don't know what you're negotiating. I don't know what your objective is, but the point is overcome his stall and objection up front. Sir, I'd ask this, give him a stroke, say, I'm glad you asked. I have excellent credit. I'd be glad to give that to you. If you believe that I have the best credit in the world, can we go ahead and do a transaction today?
Okay.
So what you do is you overcome the objection and then you find out from him, can you really do the deal? I mean, do you want to fill that out, send him all this stuff, then chase him again, then start negotiating on the deal on a second and third phone call? Don't you want to close? This is the point. Can you close them in the first phone call by overcoming them their stall and objections?
Okay.
Can you negotiate in the first phone call? Sir, if I give you that information and it shows I have the best credit in the world, are you the owner of the property? Can you negotiate today? Can we do owner finance? Can you discount the property? Can we do a rent to own today for 3 years at $1,500 a month? Boom. Go right into the negotiation. See, you take his objection and you say, sir, you compliment him. And then you say, you know what, I would do the same thing. Let's, for a moment, let's assume that I have the best credit you've ever seen and everything else. Then you move into the negotiation right away. So now you saved yourself that second, third, fourth phone call, the follow-ups, the voicemail. You go right to the heart of the matter in the first phone call. Let's reverse it. Somebody be, Ben Jasso, you're going to help me with the role play here, Ben?
Yeah.
Ben, thank you for calling. Yes, the house is available. Would you mind filling out an application, a credit application?
I'm happy to do that. I'll send you over the application. And I have a copy of my latest credit report. I think you'll find the score satisfactory. Let me ask you this, Claude. After you look it over, we've got a bunch of things going on this week, of course. Can we speak in an hour? And when we do, what's going to happen next?
Oh, yeah, we can speak it out. Off the role play, why not speak right now?
Right.
Okay. You don't know what the deal is yet. Why don't we negotiate the deal right now and then have a follow-up appointment, if necessary, in an hour?
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you go forward? Because do you know what's in their mind, what they want to sell it for, what the terms are and everything?
Okay.
Yeah. So go for it quick. DQ, do it quick. Sometimes, why not? When you get them on the phone, how hard is it to get prospects on the phone?
It's hard.
Oh, man. It's very hard, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's get them on the phone, keep them when on. You get them on the phone, go for it. I know what some of you might say, well, maybe that's a little pushy. That's a little bit too assertive. You may not get another chance to get them on the phone.
Right.
Brandon, will you chime in on this? What do you think about when you get them on the phone? Should you just go for it, or should you be the sweetheart and set up multiple follow-ups and appointments when you got a live one on the phone?
Always make the offer.
Can it hurt?
Always make the offer. Can it hurt? Always try to get a commitment.
Why don't we? Why?
No,
we...
I've been training some sales guys, and they're very nervous, right? They're scared to kind of make that offer or to
why?
Piss someone off or to
why?
Hurt their feelings, because they're afraid that they're going too low or they're going to say no, right? I'm like, guess what? If they hang up, you can call them right back. You can. So I actually did that. I wanted them to like go through that rejection process a little bit, and we're like, sorry, we can't do business. Have them hang up. Now call them back and just say you got permission from your manager to make a better offer.
Yeah.
And then build that, you know, then you're right back in the game.
When a salesperson is reluctant to go for it and is just totally acquiescent to the prospect, okay, yeah, we can talk later. Oh, whatever you want and everything. What doesn't that show kind of a salesperson who is desperate or has all the time in the world or is just not busy? I like that I like that scarcity social proof thing from Cialdini. I use it every day. Brandon, I got so many people calling me and everything. Here's my problem, Brandon. I don't even want to look over everything and talk about the house on Tuesday or Wednesday. I have so many people call. Is there any way we could discuss it right now? And if you want to say no, that's okay. But if you want to say yes, because you see the value in the deal, we'll take it off the market and protect you. Could we do that for another 5 minutes? Is that all right?
You bet. Yeah, let's do that.
Okay, because if you call me, if I talk, here's my problem. I've got so many phone calls. It's Monday. Look at all these phone numbers. This is the way people lose deals. And I think you're really interested in this. Why do I feel that way?
Because I'm ready to buy today.
I thought so. I thought, the money's not an issue. You have the $25,000 down payment.
Right. And also, Claude, whenever I'm talking to sellers or my guys, I always make sure that they, you know, you got to use that scarcity or time sensitive, like we only have a certain amount of funds. We're only able to buy a certain amount of properties this month. So we'd like it to be yours. If not, we're looking at a few others, you know, almost like you almost want to have that, the Conor McGregor swag, like you don't care.
Can't be afraid to walk away from the negotiation.
Yeah. Say it again, Bailey. That was brilliant.
Can't be afraid to walk away from the negotiation.
What's the message you're sending them? Sir, listen, I'd love to call you next Wednesday or Thursday. That'd be great. And if I have the property still, I doubt I will because I'm getting so many. Why don't we just say it's over at this point? Is that all right? I don't want to bother you and everything because it's going to go. It's just going to go. It's just the way it is. How would you like to be a car salesman today? Okay. I just got a new car, a new lease. Okay. I had to reserve that car 4.5 weeks. Before it was delivered, was on some boat on some train somewhere or where, whatever, 4.5 weeks to get a car in advance. How would you like to be those salespeople? You know, they're charging over sticker prices now for cars.
Yes, they are.
That hasn't happened since since World War II.
Right.
In the 50s when they had shortages.
Yeah, the chip shortage now and used car shortage and all this. Bumping the prices up is massive.
Don't you love to sell things when you have a mindset of scarcity and you're going to the you really want to make a sale? It's a Monday morning, but the prospect is manipulating you with think about it. It's, oh, I'll check, you know, and all that. And you go to them and say, look, maybe it's over. Can you fire the prospect? Why do we say that term, fire the prospect? Almost pushing them away. Why do we do that?
Scarcity.
Scarcity.
And also we got to remember that. Go ahead, Claude.
No, you go. I'm sorry. I talk too much. You go ahead.
Well, you know, being able to push the prospect away, or at least fire the prospect, puts the power back in our hands, saves us time. We also know when we had someone that's, you know, just pushing a wheelbarrow and they're not really interested in doing the deal. You know, it gives us a bit of confidence as well too, because we're not suffering from rejection. We're actually rejecting them. So it's a big psychological strength.
Trailer King, jump in here on pushing the prospect away using confidence. What do you think about that?
So I actually did that this week.
Tell us about it.
I had there's a prospect down in Panama City, Florida. He's got problems with the house, needs a new roof. He's arguing with the insurance company. I just want to be done with it. His exact words. Great. So you're ready to do something today? Yes, I am. Fantastic. We agreed upon a price. I sent him the contract. He said, well, I need to think about this for a couple of days. I said, using Claude's words, I'm sorry, I can't allow you to do that.
Woo!
Why not? You told me you were ready to do something today. I make several offers a week. I can't allocate funds and not close business. My partners will kill me. So, you know, I'm just going to avoid the deal. Well, don't do that. Don't do that. I said, I'm sorry, I have to. And I basically hung up on him and voided the deal. He then called me back a half a dozen times over the next 2 days. I ignored him the first three times, but then we started talking again. He got his son involved. We got the deal done. So
a round of applause.
Yeah. It was, it just, they will, to get to the price, sellers will say anything. I want to hear your offer. Yes, 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 I'm ready to do a deal. And then, geez, I got to think about it.
That took guts.
I'm sorry, somebody said something.
I said that took guts.
That's a guts what?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, but you
the move that he did.
Guts, I think, is what he said.
Yeah.
Guts. I'm driving in the car. I don't know if you're hearing me clearly.
We can hear you.
Okay. Nice. I just said that I didn't want to use another word, but I'm using a nice word. That took guts.
It's a guts move.
Absolute.
It's a guts move, and it says it's a dangerous move. Here's one of my favorite quotes. Sales, I used to hear it from my mentor all the time. Sales is dangerous. You don't know how they're always going to react. Maybe they're going to get mad at you. Maybe they're going to hang up the phone. Oh, what do you mean I'm not allowed to think about it, Roger? No one's ever said that to me before. I don't like this pressure you're putting me under, buddy.
Well, being the nice guy is not going to get you anywhere. I'm sorry. You've got to be in the driver's seat in the deal from the beginning of the conversation to the end. And if you're not, and they don't want to play the game, okay, well, it's over. We'll move on. Thank you.
It's a very delicate piece of surgery. And sometimes you do want them. Number one persuasion technique is likability and trust. Do they like you? Do they trust you? They want someone who to believe in, okay? They want somebody who can solve their problem. Here's the problem. Your competition out there are such weenies. Okay. Oh, Mr. Prospect, Miss Prospect, whatever you want. Yeah. Oh, don't worry. I'll send it to you. And don't worry. We'll talk next week. That's your competition. And your prospects are so used to people behaving like that, that when they meet a good a gut salesman like you, Roger, who's assertive, but still nurturing. Notice the word I use. It's a delicate balance of being assertive, using a little social proof. Hey, I got a lot of other clients calling me today. So if you want to say no, that's all right. But, you know, listen, I'd love to do business with you. You sound like a great guy. I think this is the perfect. You got to go back. It's like you go back and forth, that pendulum on the grandfather clock. First you go nurturing. Then you go very specifically where you tell them, hey, look, this is I'm going to use my authority right now. This is the way it's going to work. This is the way we're going to play. It's my ball, and I'll take it home if we can't play by these rules. But I'd love to do business with you. It's so delicate, you know?
Claude, and I don't want to come across like I was a tough guy the entire time. The conversation went very well. We had a good relationship going. We talked. We did the dance. We went down. He said all the right things. I said all the right things. When he went back on his word is when I flipped.
Yeah.
He said, no, I'm sorry. Not going to happen.
Yeah.
And they're not used to people doing that. They're used to salespeople going, "Ooh, okay, well, how much time do you need? Would a couple of days be all right? Can I follow back up with you on Friday?"
Oh, yeah.
Exactly what he wanted to hear.
Yeah. And then you get out the boohoo tissues because you can't find them anymore. They've disappeared. You're leaving voicemails. You're chasing them. What's that? And the message you send to that prospect is, I can call him anytime. Oh, I think I'll wait a few days and then I'll renegotiate the deal. They don't respect you. What happens when they don't respect you?
They start to tread business. On you.
Yeah.
You're like a second-class citizen. It's not fun.
Yeah. There's a happy medium in business.
Yeah.
Okay, there's a happy medium. But if you're a pushover, you're dead. You're not going to make the money. You're not going to close. The only deals you're going to get are the fall down prospects. The ones who are ready, they just want to give it to you. You know, that 1 out of 1,000 that are just ready to deals. But how do the top salespeople in any business, gold coins, insurance, real estate, financial services, what do the top people do in their business that none of the competitors do?
They assert authority.
Yeah. Sales is very dangerous. Okay. Here's one of my things. Is sales a place to, here's a dangerous little thing. I have it here on my screen here. Let me share my screen here for a second before we run out of time. One of my favorite ones here. Truth or lie, Mr. Prospect, you know? You want me to tell you the truth? Here's a great one. Mr. Prospect, I have made a decision. Somebody close me with that. That is an assertive, that is pure guts assertiveness. You've had a discussion, they have a problem, your product or service can solve it. What does the good gut salesman do? You've done your agenda, you've had a good discussion, the money's there, the problem and pain is there, you know your product, service, your offer is reasonable. Now you go into the close and you say, I have made a decision, and you tell them they will buy the thing. Anybody here have the guts to do that in a role play? Who wants to go for it? How about one of the ladies? Suzette, you ready to beat me up? Tell me.
Hello. Yes. Sure. Let's try it.
Tell me you've made a decision. You're the gut salesperson, and I'm the wishy-washy prospect. Okay. Yeah, this sounds really good, Suzette. This is kind of what I've been looking for. And I think we can do the, I think it'll work in our budget. You know, it sounds really good.
Okay, Claude, I'm glad to hear that you're ready to make a decision and to move forward. And that way you can move on what you're planning on doing. I think I made a decision today, Claude.
You think? Don't use ambiguity. Don't. It works both ways. Don't.
Oh, I did say I think. No, no, no.
You did, and I heard it. So I'm going to jump all over.
I know. I thought I said it quietly.
I want you to pound your fist on Claude. I have made a decision, and then reiterate all the closing issues that are all the problems. Claude, this is your problem. This is the budget. This is the timeliness. I've made a decision. We're going to fix this today. Go ahead. Be assertive and pound your hand on the table. Well, I want, you know, Claude, I think we can do something here pretty soon, Suzette.
You think? Is that what you said?
Yeah, I like everything about your company, and you returned my phone calls, and my wife really likes you. This sounds fairly, you know, pretty good. We're probably, you know, this is kind of what I was looking for.
Kind of, probably. Okay. Claude, I made a decision.
Pound. I
want to work with you today. I want to work with you today. I want to make this work for you. I want to help you move forward. You know, I think this is the best option for you and your family to move forward. And
I heard that think word again.
I got to get rid of that word, man.
When you say think,
take out wants to take out think. Yeah.
Take out think, and what else?
You feel this is a good decision.
Take out I want to work with you and take out, I think I'm ready to move forward. So take out think and want and just be definite.
Cool. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah. Stroke and nurture me while making assertive statements. Claude, I have made a decision. I'm going to take care of you and your wife. This is the deal. It's going to work, and it's going to work in your budget. It's going to solve all the A, B, C, D, E, F problems we said. We're going to make a commitment today. I've made this decision, and we're going to solve, and your problems are over. How do you feel about that?
Okay.
Wouldn't you love to meet a person who's not bullying you, but they're being assertive in your best interest? That's what we're going for here.
Yeah.
Don't you love that person?
And it's a,
I like people like that. Maybe I'm wrong. Tell me.
No, I do too. I do too. And it is a word game. So using the right words, it really, you don't have to be tough. Just using the right words, it makes it work. That's where I need to work on. Remembering those strong words that say what I need to say.
Yeah. Assertiveness can be such a good thing when the prospect perceives it as being in their best interest. What are they going to say about you, Suzette? When I get off the phone, what am I going to say to my wife about Suzette Galleon?
That you trust me, that you had a pleasure having, you know, doing business with me and my company, that you feel really good.
Yeah. Yeah.
She's looking out for you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, say that was great, Jessica.
That she's looking out for you, you know, taking care of you.
Somebody who you got off the phone. How much is personality involved? We got the product, we got the service, we got all the brochures, we got the PowerPoint display. But when you get down to it, the personality of the person you're dealing business with, how important is that?
Hey. Very important. Yeah.
Isn't it huge?
It's huge.
Yes,
huge.
What happens when a small business person, a kitchen table person, and you're in a competitive field and everything, but you've been talking to assistants, you've been getting voicemails, you've been texting back and forth, and you get a real person on the phone who speaks in that assertive manner like Suzette just did. What happens to your competition that spends all that money, they spend all that money on marketing and they've got a fancy office and everything like that. And you're just a little person on a kitchen table, but you touch that person. What happens to your
competition?
You devastated your competition. Mm-hmm. Because what do people really want in the end?
Feel heard, connection.
Connection. Solution. Tell me about connection. What's connection mean?
People want to do business with people they know, like, and trust. So if you have an emotional connection with somebody and, you know, you hit their buttons and actually make them feel like you truly care about them, and they're not just a number, they're going to want to work with you.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. It stops all the shopping around for the cheapest, the closest, the biggest advertiser and everything else. Mm-hmm. It's just that connection. I love the words you used, Bailey. Thank you. They were great words.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Good words. Mr. Cash Offer's in the building even. How you doing there, Chris? Let's go to another slide here for a second. Let's find some of these are good topics. Never ask for the order when you can get the prospect to do what?
Give it to you.
Give it to you. How do we close somebody without begging?
Chris. All right, Claude.
Go ahead, Claude. Go ahead, Chris. You're the salesman.
All right. All right, Claude. Yeah. No, I. So, how do you feel about that? Does this sound like this is workable for you? Are you okay? Are you comfortable with everything
It's pretty good. I like everything you had to say. I mean, you sound like this is kind of what I was looking for.
Kind of what you were looking for. So let me just imagine for a second, Claude. So if you got, you know.
Ooh, he's using my own shit against me now. Listen to this. He used that imagine word. Did everybody hear it?
Yeah.
Why do we love that word? And why is Chris so brilliant to use it right now? Why is that word so important?
Paints a picture in the prospect's mind of what the outcome is that you're going to bring to them.
Yeah, you're putting it in their mind now. Go ahead, Chris. Sorry to interrupt.
No, it's fine. It's fine. Anytime. So imagine, Claude, just close your eyes for a second. You got the money. You were able to walk away with a big check that you wanted. You and your wife were comfortable with that. You're able to move to that new property that you guys had already lined out. And this was done in the next 30, 45 days, exactly like you guys wanted. And you were able to finally take your wife on that vacation. I mean, isn't that what you want, Claude?
Yeah, I think so. Now tell me you made a decision. Just close me. You know, that's
I like Claude,
Claude, I've made a decision. Well, I'm going to help you today. I'm going to get you out of that property. We're going to get you on that vacation with your wife. We're going to help you and your kids.
Yeah, let's do it. That, you're right. Let's just do this.
What would you like to do next, Claude?
What do I need to do? Sign something or whatever I need. I feel really good about this. Thank you.
All right. I'm going to get that the DocuSign over to you. Can you do me a favor and sign that? Get that back to me here the next hour or so. And then also send me an email just confirming that you sent that DocuSign back to me.
I off the role play, I love that. Give me a nurture before you ask for the reciprocity. Give me a cookie here. First.
Okay.
Sorry to micro be a pain in the butt here, but this is important.
No, I love it. Jump in anytime, Claude. Claude, you're a gentleman, Claude. I love doing business with people like yourself. This is what makes me tick every day when I do business with good individuals. I love that. Like,
Nehemiah's giving little hearts across the board there.
That's the good stroke and nurture right there. You're a gentleman.
Yeah. And now go into the reciprocity. Could you do me a small favor? Go ahead.
All right, great. You're a gentleman, sir. So can you do me a small favor, Claude?
Sure.
I'm gonna get the DocuSign over to you. Can you get that back to me today before 1 o'clock?
Oh, I can I can do it right now. Just send it to me. I'll get it back to you in 5 minutes.
All right. I'm putting that together. I'm getting that over to you right now. It's gonna take me about 10 minutes, but that's gonna be in your email here shortly. Can you send me an email confirmation letting me know after you've completed the DocuSign?
Oh yeah, I'm done. I've made a decision. I love the way you do business, man. Thank you. You've made this is great. Thank you.
No, and I thank you. I look forward to working with you. Have a smooth transaction, sir. And I love doing business with smart individuals like yourself. I mean,
double stroke. He's super stroking me.
Well, you say never let a compliment. You always compliment the person. Never let them just compliment you and let it fall.
You know, when they give you a compliment, you cannot leave it one-sided. You've always got to give it back. Because if you don't return the compliment, you can go from love to, well, maybe I don't know, or maybe even dislike. You've got to be equal standing. There's a better expression. I can't think of it right now. But same thing. So when they say something, Chris, give me a compliment, Chris, like a prospect would.
Claude, man, I wouldn't have been able to sell this house without you. If anybody asked for a recommendation on somebody to purchase house or anything like that, I'm definitely going to be you. I don't know what I'm doing without you.
I can't tell you how much you just made my day. This is what I love business, because I get to work with the Scott family. I got, working with you and meeting your wife and kids and everything. This is the greatest pleasure of my life. Just doing business with clients like you. Thank you so much. Oh, yeah. It's a bro fest. Okay. Is that prospect going to call you up the next day? Oh, my wife's mad at me. Oh, we don't have the money. Not if you did everything else right in the early part. We're going out of time. Oh, this is great. I love role plays like this. Thank you guys so much. I've got a dangerous one. I got one more here. Can we do one more? Mm-hmm. I think this is one of the more controversial ones. Let me share my screen here with you guys. We've had this discussion before. This is a tough one, guys. Is sales a place to stroke your ego and get your emotional needs satisfied? True or false? Is sales a place to get your need, your ego, the salesperson's? Pardon the expression, a pissing match with a skunk? Did you ever get a nasty prospect Okay, my friend Niles Larson from Kentucky told me that expression. He also taught me the other one, Don. Don't pee on my back and tell me it's raising. I love these Southern metaphors. They're fantastic. Everybody knows what bless your heart really means, right? But is sales, let's talk about sales, is an ego. Are we in an egotistical business?
Yes.
We're in business. What happens if, you know, that's why I say the salesperson comes first. If we're going out there and we're getting our tuchus kicked all day long, we're getting rejection, we're getting manipulated, we're being treated rudely. How does that affect our ego state?
It brings us down. Yeah, it makes us, we don't want to make those calls.
This is so important. We need to protect our ego all the time. That's why we talked today about rejection, qualification. I have made a decision. When's the last time you ever heard a salesperson say, I have made a decision, or is it over, or you're not allowed to think about it? I'm still waiting to, other than a gut sales training session, I never hear salespeople talk like this. How important is it for you guys to protect the way you feel about yourself?
Paramount.
Critical.
But here's where it gets dangerous now. If you sound like a bully, or you sound like a braggart, or you know, to the prospect, are they going to like and trust you?
No.
So this is kind of a controversial little, is sales a place to get your ego, to stroke your ego and get your emotional needs met? The answer is
no.
Ooh, so no. Okay.
Yes and no. How about that?
It's a yes, no answer. I really, this is subjective. I don't have the last word on this. This is my opinion. I think we have to play a role. You guys always hear me say the role versus the identity, the thespian. We're going to play a role to get that prospect to like and trust us while still maintaining a balance of being assertive. But we cannot let the prospect manipulate us and reject us all day long. Otherwise, we won't make any more phone calls. Yeah. So, I think it was Bill who jumped in. I'll let you disagree or argue with me on this one. You've got an opinion. I think it's a place to get your ego and your emotional needs satisfied, but you better not let the prospect know about it during the conversation. What do you think about that?
Absolutely.
That works.
When you do a good job, then you give yourself an ego boost, right?
When you get off the phone and you got a sale, a contract, a commitment, a new appointment, and you're jumping up and down and it's happy time, okay? You do your little dance and everything. That's when you celebrate. But you don't want to get into, did you ever get nasty with the prospect was nasty to you and then you were nasty to them? Does that bring you closer or further apart?
Further apart.
Close it up.
Why are we in business?
To help people.
I'll agree with that. But we're in business to take care of our families, and pay our bills. And we're in business to get commitment contracts to make money today, because the salesperson always comes first in the gut sales, because you're good people. Mm-hmm. I know you study hard, you work hard, your products, your services, the real estate, and whatever you do, is you're the good guys. You're giving value to people, and you're working smart. Aren't you entitled to be compensated when?
No.
Today.
Mm-hmm. I have an amen from the church choir, please.
Amen.
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 Okay, good stuff. Good stuff today. Anything else before we go? We're almost out of time. You guys want to do one more, or you got a question?
One more.
Let's go. Let me go to my share screen here. Let me find a good one. Let's see. Prospects make decisions emotionally. We know that. Using guts on a cold call. Now, let me find another good one here. Oh my
God. I have a question for you, Claude.
Okay.
What about someone that's not really ready or qualified to buy yet?
Good. Okay. You have a prospect on a 1 through 10, they're a 5 or 6. They're not ready yet. They're not emotionally motivated or involved. They're not ready to pull the trigger. Is that what you're saying?
Right. Right.
What do you do So what do you think you should do with that person? What would be the next? You want to leave the door open for a follow-up, don't you, at least?
Yes.
You know, and so you still do your agenda step. You qualify them. You know after a few minutes, they're not ready to make the move just yet. So you leave the door open. Brandon, you know what? You stroke and nurture. Brandon, I've really enjoyed this conversation. I'm going to send you a little gift and some follow-up information on this. And it sounds to me like you're not ready to make a decision just yet. Is this something you want to do in June, July, next year? What's your time frame for all this?
Maybe in a few months. I'm just trying to save some money up and feel like I'm in a more ready in a position where I'm ready to move forward.
I respect that.
I just need a little bit more time.
I respect that, and thank you for sharing that with me. I'm going to send you some information. Why don't we have a follow-up appointment? I'll set it right now. Why don't we make it April 15th, tax day, and just follow up and see if the situation changed or if there's better opportunities. Does that make sense?
That makes sense.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, before I go, who remembers Columbo? Who remember Columbo, Peter Falk? Remember the move? He had the raincoat, his hair was all, and he'd go to the door. Oh, before I go. Okay. Now, this is when if you have something up your sleeve, say for instance, Brandon, you know, it's 99% of the time, Brandon, it's a money issue, isn't it?
Usually.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's assume this is a situation where you have the flexibility to finance. Okay, and you let them off the hook, you showed them you're not pushy, you have a follow-up appointment, then you say, what? And you just do that Columbo move. You say, you know what, Brandon, just had an idea here. It's okay to say no to me, don't worry. It wouldn't make a difference if we were to finance this so that you could enjoy the house, the gold coins, the insurance policy, the used car. If there was a way we could finance this and make it comfortable for you right now, you wouldn't want to take advantage of that and have this problem resolved, would you?
Possibly. What did you have in mind exactly?
Oh, great. Thank you for asking. Boom. Then you go back into it again. Did you hear the negative redirection, by the way? Who picked that up? Who heard the negative redirection? Why do I do that? Why is that so powerful?
It pushes them to go the opposite direction.
Yeah, because things in motion stay in motion. If I go hard negative, what's the likely place that Brandon's going to go? Positive.
Positive.
Exactly. So you always keep an ace up your sleeve. If you know there's a problem, but they're only a 4 or 5, they're not emotionally in, then at the last second, if you can, oh, wait, I just remembered, just one more thing. It wouldn't make a difference if... It wouldn't make a difference. And then you give it a shot for financing or whatever else. Follow-up is always important. Last word, because we're out of time here. Follow-up. Anytime you speak to somebody, send them a text, send them a video. I do videos because I think it's much more personal. Send them an email with an embedded video. It's so easy to do. Send them a PDF. Send them some information. Do some research for them. Send them a link on a Wall Street Journal article that relates to what maybe you were talking about. Send them a gift of something. I'm always sending people free books, mind maps, follow-up videos. What does that say to them when right away you send them a follow-up? What does that say?
Looking to take care of them, you're thinking about it.
Yeah, you're professional. You're still in their mind right away. How long do you think a prospect remembers us after a phone conversation?
Not long.
Their memory is very short. It's your responsibility. Send them something right away, even if it's just a thank you. Hey, Mr. Simmons, I really enjoyed meeting you and your family. I hope we can do business in the future. I've attached some information here and an agreement for you to look at. I know you're not ready, but if you'd like to, here's my personal phone number so you can call me directly. I really enjoyed our conversation. I'd love to earn your trust and do business with you. You're a great guy. Have a good day. Boom. Do you think a lot of salespeople take that 30 seconds to do that kind of stuff?
No.
It's all about, what were the words? There was some great words. somebody was using, Bailey was using earlier, about making that connect, that emotional connection with people. What do you want them to say to you? Even if you don't do a deal with them, what do you want them to say about you when you get off the phone?
I like that person. I like. Yeah.
It's a righteous dude. You know what? I think I finally found a good person in a world of BS. Mm-hmm. I think I finally found a good, what happens when you're in their mind, like a bad song all day long, and you follow up with a video or a gift or some other information? What do you think, what's the possibility that can happen?
Much better.
Huge.
They might call you back. Anybody here ever have a prospect said, you love when you hear this. You know what, Ben, Mr. Jasso, I've been thinking all day about those gold investment coins. You know, I really enjoyed our conversation, and you sent me that information right away. Nobody does that. I've been thinking about you all day long. Do you have a minute? I want to ask you a few more questions.
Yes, Claude. What can I do?
Okay, give me a cookie. Come on, call me. Give me a cookie.
I'm glad you called me back, Claude. Pleasure to hear from you.
Why is that so important?
Sounds good.
Why am I a pain in the butt about that stuff?
Because it creates that connection. It creates that environment of like a conversation.
Yeah. Yeah. You're rewarding him. Oh, you know, you can do the same thing. Whoops. Didn't mean for that to come on. You're rewarding them. They might be a little, I'm sorry to bother you. I know I was talking earlier. No, I'm so glad you called. I've been thinking about you too today, you know, and I was thinking I'd love to do business with you. Is there any questions, anything else I can help you with? I'm so glad you called. Thank you. Boom. That stroking and nurturing. Whew. You got to get into that habit of automatically doing that all day long. And that relaxes them. I'm so glad I called him back. He even likes that I called him back. Now you got another shot to close, don't you?
Yeah.
Why are we in business? Why are we in business? Everybody, to make money today. Everybody, give yourselves a round. Great session today. Thank you. A lot of energy here. And everything. Brandon Simmons, give yourself a plug here. How do folks reach you? You always have good stuff.
BrandonTheMan.com. Just go to BrandonTheMan.com. If I can help anyone in the group, I'd love to.
When's your next real estate seminar, Brandon? Brandon does the best seminars.
We're looking in May again. We do a monthly mastermind. So if you're ever in Phoenix, look me up. We do the REI mastermind. It's the hashtag Go Giver after the Go Giver book. We had Wendy Patton on our panel last week.
She's great.
Yeah, she's phenomenal. Talked about, you know, she wrote the book on lease options and subject to stuff too. We had a couple other great guys talking about notes. So a lot of creative stuff. We have about 200 of the top flippers and wholesalers here in Phoenix that are doing deals nationwide. And so it's a free mastermind. I've never charged for it, but I've done deals.